In the late 1980s, after designing and analysing and promoting solar housing for about 12 years at the time, we decided to be involved in a solar movie that was put together by a TV station to explain what solar design was in the housing sector. We had developed the Solar Energy Information Centre that was developed to educate and make people aware of the benefits of using solar energy. And the TV host, David Grant, approached us to showcase four houses. And those designs were from a basic design, affordable house, up to a luxury design in Dalkeith, which is a fairly prominent, wealthy area in Perth. It showed that the concept of solar design was truly egalitarian. There's no discrimination against the rich. No, seriously. It was showed that it could be done on an affordable basis for everybody. Everyone could save energy. Everyone could contribute to the reduction of carbon pollution.
Solar design, how to harness that marvellous resource, the sun and the wind for that matter, to make life at home a little easier, particularly if you're planning or building a new home. The one thing that does come out in the study of four houses that's most important is that a lighthouse need not necessarily be a hothouse. We're going to meet the architect of the four properties, in fact, Gary Baverstock, but first, let's call on the four owners to give us their opinions on what it's like to live in a house with a solar design influence. Our first house is a small project home in Bayswater, built as much as a demonstration model as a residence for its single occupant.
It naturally, and my skin tells me that it naturally, it's naturally comfortable as opposed to artificial comfort we get in our offices and other places. And it maintains for my comfort a very even temperature throughout the year, no matter what extreme of temperature is on the outside.
Now to Stoneville in the hills behind Mundaring, where a retired professional couple have made a total study of solar design.
Well, it's a house that if you work it well, it responds well. If you're not interested in making it work, well, it won't do as well as it could do. So you have to close it when it's very hot outside, not leave the windows and doors open, and then it keeps you very pleasantly cool.
Our third house is at Kingsley, a family home on a block deliberately purchased for its northerly aspect.
Every morning of the year, it's never necessary to turn on a light unless you get up particularly early, but the normal waking time, the house is already light and bright as soon as you get up.
The fourth home in our study is at Dalkeith, the largest of the four and perhaps the most difficult to design.
Oh, it's excellent. In summer, it's very much cooler. We don't get any sun in the house in summer because the solar pergolas are very efficient and angled correctly. And in winter, it allows the sun to come right into the house and warm it up. And of course, the tiled floor acts as a heat bank, and it's always a pleasant temperature to walk on, even in the middle of winter.
Now to architect Gary Baverstock, who explains the underlying aims of solar design.
Passive solar houses in temperate climates can save between 60 to 90% of energy bills and maintain comfort between 18 to 28 degrees all year round. So you're living in luxury and you're not having to pay for it. You're simply using the weather, the ambient air temperatures to your advantage. And I think once that message gets clearly through, then we're going to see some significant changes in subdivisional design, and we're going to see substantial changes in people's thinking about how they put their designs together.
In a moment, we'll show just how these four homes were designed for solar sense. But first, we need to understand what happens in the WA sky. Dr. Bill Parker at the Solar Information Centre in South Perth explains with the help of a model.
What I'm going to do now is show you the winter sun pattern. It rises to the north of east, about 30 degrees north of east, and only comes up in the sky to a fairly low angle, and that's about it. So that's why we put the windows on the north, to capture that sun. Summer's a completely different picture. This is midsummer day, sun is rising to the south of east by quite a long way, and before even 10 o'clock we've had a lot of heat on that side, that hence the reason for minimizing the windows. But the dramatic thing is that the sun appears to sit up there in the sky for a substantial part of the day. And likewise, minimizing the windows on the west, same thing again. The five major points are, put simply, getting the orientation right so that you've got the house that way round on the block with the north there. You've got the windows right, minimize the windows on the east and the west, most of the windows on the north. You're using solid materials for construction to store winter heat, primarily. You're providing adequate ventilation by the placement of the house with regard to the breezes and bringing the breeze right through passively. And you're really, the other essential is to minimize heat flow by insulation, both summer and winter.
The houses were all designed by the one architect, Gary Baverstock. But Bayswater and Stoneville, for example, varied considerably in size.
And basic principles that are exactly the same. Similar glass areas on the north, same orientation, same rules of orientation, same rules of shading, getting the winter sun in through the north, on the windows on the north. But there's one small difference is that the collection area is actually partially on the roof in this house, and we're able to reduce the glass area on the actual north wall and put it into the middle of the house to help heat the south rooms. The size of the house as it increases means that you get a greater depth in the north-south direction, and you tend to find that if you don't do anything about it, you end up with a dark spot in the middle of the house. And usually with modern plans these days, open plans and centralized kitchens, it's a good idea to make that the brightest place in the house, not the darkest. And it also gives you the freedom as you get a bigger house, if you've got views, say, on the south side of a house, as in this case, you can put some of the living areas on the south side and allow the winter sun to come through the roof and strike the floor on the south side of the house. With bigger plans, you get dark spots in the middle of the house, and that's where skylights, clear story windows, properly designed to shade in summer and expose the sun in winter, gets the winter sun back into the middle of the house and makes it light and bright and airy, where it's usually the darkest in most plans. So that would be a fundamental difference between the simple plan, which is small, and a more architectural design, which is a lot larger usually.
The large home in Dalkeith had that controlled light source in the centre, but another flooding the entry hall to the south.
Well, that works very well. It allows light to enter the house all the time. There are no dark holes in the house. But the sun doesn't penetrate in summer because there's an overhang which is sufficient to block the sun.
All four property owners vouched for increased efficiency in following solar design principles.
Well, the electricity bills are minimal, really, very tiny compared with the previous bills that we were paying. We use very little electricity, and we use gas, about one cylinder per 6 months, for cooking only. So it's cheap.